Well, boys, looks like you started the fun without me.
You're all sick. Every last one of you.
We're going to need a bigger gun.
What's the matter? You scared of things that go boom?
Give me one goddamn reason why I shouldn't blow your goddamn brains all over that goddamn wall.
My name is Eric, and I'm here with lycanthropist Michael Kester, and I did write that out phonetically in my notes, and we are making our way through some hostile situations today. What two films are we doing?
Dog Soldiers first, and Bruce Willis's Hostage second.
So we're going to spoil these films.
Yeah.
But, you know, sometimes it just seems obnoxious when you... Yeah, one film is werewolves, and the other is a Bruce Willis hostage thriller.
Yeah.
There's not a whole lot of spoiling that goes on
You can
here.
Spoil Hostage to death.
Yeah, I guess they both have kind of twists and turns.
Yeah, they do.
Sort of.
This is weird. Right. This is the first one in a while that we could actually spoil.
Maybe we're just used to not being able to spoil the films. I guess that's it. We have chapters embedded in the feed, so you can just skip from movie to movie if you haven't seen one of the films. You can do that in iTunes, QuickTime, or on your iPod. You'll figure it out. It's you're a smart listener. Let's do Dog Soldiers.
Cool,
first.
Dog Soldiers. Neil Marshall's Dog Soldiers.
Yeah, Neil Marshall wrote, directed, and edited this film.
He did.
I love when directors edit their own films.
I know.
That makes me really happy.
That's the Robert Rodriguez staple right there.
So
just get it out of the way.
So who is this Neil Marshall guy that you brought to me?
Neil Marshall is one of my favorite directors who only directs movies that start with D. He did Dog Soldiers. He did The Descent. His last effort was Doomsday, and his upcoming effort is Drive.
Yeah, he's one of these guys who constantly has a bunch of things like in the fire, but you never really see them.
Right. And they all start with D for some reason.
The first one of his films I saw was Descent. We actually did that, you know, on the show. And then I think it was on my birthday that we went and saw Doomsday.
I love Doomsday.
This is a guy.
I love it to death.
Who at Doomsday, I think, is the most obvious piece of this. He's a big fan of, you know, basically making entire films out of like homages to shit you watch when you
Absolutely.
Were a kid.
Kind of the Quentin Tarantino thing, only like with a more I'm a badass twist.
Yeah.
And less of a this is my own thing and more of a I've always wanted to do this.
Well, and where Tarantino will kind of like take a concept and sort of build different scenes.
Sure.
Or even, I guess, overall concepts out of older films he liked or more obscure films. Neil Marshall basically goes, zombies, I'm going to stick that in there. That'll be the first third.
And, right.
I don't know. We'll have those Australian Mel Gibson movies in there. That's totally fine too.
Cool.
And we'll just throw some medieval shit in the end.
Yeah, right. But I've always wanted to do a high-speed car chase.
Right.
So we'll have them find an expensive vehicle.
Yeah, exactly. I think we're seeing that again here.
Totally.
With Dog Soldiers, maybe in a more subtle way.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there's a whole lot of like werewolf homages here.
No.
You know, coming from the guy who did Doomsday, what I expected of was a lot of like weird Lon Chaney references or like Wolfman or something. And there's none of that here.
Nothing.
Like the references they're pulling. So I know there's one that you've been dying to talk about on the show since we've seen this.
So there's a character in the film who's introduced right away. His name's Witherspoon. They refer to him as Spoon from like the very first scene until the very end where he gets devoured by werewolves after failing to kill them.
Right.
One of the many failed attempts to kill the werewolves. And the captain comes down with Cooper and Cooper's like, "Where's Spoon?" And the captain goes, "There is no Spoon."
And this has to be a Matrix reference.
Totally.
Right? Absolutely.
Yeah.
And you know, it's funny because all the other references this film pulls are like, you know, it's old shit. It's shit he probably grew up with.
Uh-huh.
So you have the H.G. Wells reference. I mean, it's Sergeant like Harry G. Wells or something.
Right.
So there's that. And then you have, do you remember the name of the corporate? It's Corporate Bruce. Full name in the credits is Corporate Bruce Campbell.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So it's just like, it's mostly character names and shit like that, or the Spoon joke. The Spoon joke stands out because it's a reference from a movie that came out, what, like 3 years before this movie?
Yeah.
And probably the most obnoxious setup for a joke ever.
But I think that's what makes it work. And I wanted to ask you whether like, because it's totally possible that Neil Marshall was like, you know, sitting with friends or on his own. I'm not sure like what type of person Neil Marshall is.
Right.
It's possible that he was like, what if I had a character named Spoon and he got eaten by werewolves? And then his friends were like, where's Spoon? And
you're thinking premise for the film here.
And another one says, there is no Spoon. Neil Marshall goes, I need to make a werewolf movie.
I really hope that's how it came together. All right, before we even like dive into any of this, I want to try and give you a summary of what happened here.
A summary lacking the various UK dialects.
Right, yeah. Well, there's two reasons that this is This suffers from what I'm going to call snatch syndrome, because that sounds awesome. It's one of those movies where people speak in a British accent, and so I have no idea what the fuck they're talking about. They speak in very local dialects. They call things footy. Like, I have no right, idea.
Footy and bone and bollocks everywhere.
I don't know what's going on in this film. The other thing is a little bit of a format change. I wasn't even going to mention it, but since it came up, we watched the movies yesterday. We're recording today. We're going to try doing that instead of this whole run into the studio room, record, run back into the other room and watch movies, and because that is insane. So it's been a day, and I'm just going to, let's run through it really quick. Here's what I believe happens in this film. Correct me if I'm wrong. So we have Private Cooper trying out for a special. I'm going to give you the 30-second version, so I'm going to gloss over some finer details that we can hit here. Private Cooper trying out for the special forces. The dude's all like, hey, kill this dog. And he's like, I'm not going to kill that dog. And then there's like some crying in the woods and he moves on from that. Scene reminded me a lot of Equilibrium. Actually, I don't know if you remember the dog scene in that. So then you see him like 4 weeks later or something. He's with the British Army. They're on a training mission. They're all shooting blanks. And then they come across special forces who I guess they think are another British Army division at the time, but whatever. So that's where they get the real guns. Oh my God, there's werewolves. They're kind of being chased around. It's like mysterious. You don't really know what's going on yet.
You forgot. You got to mention Wells.
Oh yeah. Okay. So Wells is hanging around.
Or Ryan.
Oh yeah. Yeah. That's Ryan. Wells is the other one.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm still doing fine here.
Yeah.
So they pick up Ryan. He's all like, well, I guess I'm a guy hanging out here. I'm still alive. Mysterious things are happening. I'm not going to tell you. Then they all run into werewolves in the woods. Then they get to a house where I want to believe the bulk of the film goes down, but it's not really. It's like half of the film. But we'll get to that later. And they meet up with Megan. She's like, oh, hey, I'm just a cute zoologist. I'm just hanging out in this house. And they're like, all right, I totally buy that. So then they fight off werewolves who are like trying to break in through the windows and clawing through the door. And they shoot them through the mail slot. And then Megan's all like, well, all the werewolves are clearly hanging out in that little shack over there. So why don't you just like, you know, blow it up?
Yeah.
So they put all these canisters of propane, which, you know, are just sitting around in this house for some reason, I guess. Yeah. House in the middle of nowhere.
Sure.
I guess. All right. I buy it. Canisters of propane. They load them all into the truck. They, you know, drive it viciously into the little cabin, shack, shed, whatever the fuck that thing is. And this is beautiful here too, especially because the DVD cover mentions the film I'm going to bring up. They don't pull a Jaws here.
Yeah.
They could pull a Jaws, but they go to extreme lengths.
And not only do they go through extreme lengths, sorry to interrupt your synopsis, but I'm going to slow you down because I want to mention this. They go through what is possibly the coolest scene in the movie.
Yeah, right. Yeah, absolutely. So now there's a trail of gasoline and the guy's outside and he's trying to light the match and he's going through match by match. And the other dude comes up, bam, like
with a fucking Molotov cocktail.
Oh yeah. Yeah. That's right. He lit the Molotov and he just shucks it not at the shed, but at the ground immediately in front of him.
In slow motion.
And a pool of gasoline that I guess was leaking out or whatever was happening there, flies to the shed and the shed explodes.
Yeah.
In what has to be the highest budget thing in this film, aside from, as you pointed out, maybe the score. This is awesome because a lesser movie, Jaws, would have just shot the canisters and they would have exploded because Jaws doesn't fucking understand physics.
Yeah.
But whatever, it's been years, decades even since Jaws. So we've learned from our mistakes. Cabin blows up. This is where the film gets a little weird.
Yeah.
And this is where we're definitely going to slow it down.
Yeah.
So they come back in the house. And you know, everything, boom, explosion, explosion.
You're down to three guys. There's three guys and Megan and a dog
and
a reaction dog.
Yes. Reaction dog. And Megan does the, I just have a spiral moment in my head. Megan does the moment and she turns to them and she reveals the truth. Turns out it wasn't what you thought.
Mind freak.
So she reveals the mind freak moment. Oh my God. You didn't even know this was coming. And then she's a werewolf and that's when werewolf shit, like actually, okay, let's just pause here.
Yeah.
Let's pause right here. So up until this point, great credit to the film. The thing I think the film did better than anything else is that you have a movie where it's, you know, your survival pack of people, your five or six people or whatever, and then the werewolves. Now, this isn't a slasher film. Mm-hmm. It's not a monster film.
Right.
You know, it's a monsters film, I guess, but it's not one lone thing that is attacking them.
Right.
You know, this is more of something I'm sure will come up, Feast.
Yeah.
This is more of your Feast scenario. There's a bunch of monsters. There's a bunch of people.
There's bad guys outside and you're stuck inside.
Yeah. Bad guys outside, good guys inside.
You have to figure out how to get through the bad guys to the greater amount of outside that is outside the bad guys.
Right. Exactly. So the thing that is totally fucking awesome about this movie is usually the sort of dichotomy, the thing these movies are built around is that you try and, it's a numbers game. Yeah. There's tallies in the good guy side and tallies in the bad guy side. And you try and kill more bad guys than the bad guys can kill good guys. Make sense?
Right.
You try to outnumber them at all times.
It comes up multiple times in the film.
Right. Until you kill all of them. Except we're almost at the end of the film and there's still just as many werewolves as when we started. And
if you know, there's actually more.
Oh yeah, right. Right, because Megan.
Well, so, and Ryan and the captain.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So both of them turn.
Yeah.
So we now have
werewolf score.
Not only were no werewolves killed, but werewolves were added.
Yeah.
And there are less and less survivors every scene. Which is fucking ridiculous. It's almost kind of the zombie premise.
Sure.
So that's what I've always loved about zombie films is it's this funny numbers thing.
Mm-hmm.
In zombie films, you know, they kill off a handful of zombies, but it doesn't matter because zombies are multiplying exponentially. This is just like they weren't able to kill the werewolves because they were just sucking it up.
Yeah.
They weren't figured training.
Out, weren't trying hard enough, whatever it was.
Yeah, right. And as much as the film explored werewolf mysticism, no one seemed to know any of the rules.
Well, there's the other option you can take here, which, another one that's really comparable to this film, which is From Dusk Till Dawn.
Yeah.
Where we have the like penultimate scene, which I love. Okay. I don't know what the fuck we're dealing with, but it sure as hell looks like vampires.
Yeah, right.
What do we know about vampires? And everyone's like, holy water, silver bullets, garlic, you know, like crosses, all this shit. And they like do the breakdown. They're like, okay, let's get these things and we'll kill some fucking vampires.
Yeah.
Instead, they're like, werewolves, let's shoot them.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Let's stab them with swords.
And I guess we also need to pause here because this is another great thing that I love about this film is that they kind of go over the lore and no one buys it.
Yeah.
It's just Megan
who,
you know, normally I would accept one lone nut like believes in werewolves. Well,
and furthermore, in the intro to the film, you have this weird scene where the captain's like, I knew this guy. He got a tattoo of Satan on his ass.
Right.
He explodes and that part of his body was still preserved.
Right.
So don't believe, you know, you don't know what you think, you know?
Yeah.
And then at the same, and then werewolves and everybody's like, including the captain.
Yeah.
He's like, no.
Yeah.
Nope.
Yeah, exactly.
Not werewolves.
Yeah. That's too far. Yeah. Apparently. We'll buy into the other shit, but not the werewolves. The thing here that just blows my mind is not only is it, it's just Megan who buys into it, which, like I said, I would have accepted, but it turns out she accepts it because she's a werewolf.
Yeah. Like,
that's why she understands all this. And it's weird that she's actually like kind of helping them through the mythology. Because
well, she's
know,
like, I was
going
to, it's weird. There's this weird thing where she's like, I was going to help you, but then I decided not to.
Yeah. She just changes her mind at the end. So they go through the stuff and she's trying to convince them and they're still not buying it. It's a really hard sell.
Mm-hmm.
This is the most skeptical platoon of soldiers in training of all time.
And
in any
I mean,
film.
But that's reality too.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely.
Like anybody I know in a house surrounded by werewolves would be like, these are not werewolves.
Yeah. What the hell is happening here?
Even if you see them as plainly as these people have seen them, it's like, these are not werewolves. Well,
and I'm glad you mentioned that this film does not pull any punches with the creatures. Now we've had our debate back and forth before, and I won't rehash that. We last talked about this on The Thing, the idea of don't show the monster and whether that's good or bad. And I believe the previous stance I gave to you was that I'm now over the don't show the monster and I just want cool monsters.
Show me the fucking monster.
Yeah. But this film puts all of that aside, which is why we don't even really need to talk about it. And it's just like, this isn't a, are there monsters that are scary film? It's just like, there's werewolves. They're 9 feet tall. They look like dog.
They look like Marilyn Manson with a werewolf head.
Yeah. No, exactly. And you're just like, look, just deal with it. That's what I'm giving you. And we're
these are the werewolves.
So how do you feel about that treatment of the monster?
Oh, I fucking love it. I mean, we discussed while we were watching it that the film is kind of a low budget thing. And so you see the werewolves. They're not the scariest looking werewolves you've ever fucking seen.
Right.
You don't need to see them transform. They're not gooey and they're not weird and their eyes don't glow.
Right.
At the same fucking time, they're not human.
Yeah.
Like, what else do you need?
Yeah.
They're clearly not human. They're not a fucking wolf, but they're somewhere in between.
Yeah.
That's a werewolf.
It's certainly an approach.
Yeah.
If I can say nothing else about it. We'll get into that too, but I want to just run down the rest of the stuff in this film, just so we can check it off the list. So everybody gets fucking slaughtered and there's a hamster style.
Yeah.
Really quick. So the hamster style in here is the single worst hamster style I've ever
and
seen.
And it's
in a
so
film.
Obvious.
So that, well, that's what I mean. Hamster style. I know a lot of people haven't, it's an older show now, so people haven't heard it, But hamster style is a term we coined from Orgasmo.
Yeah.
And you can see that film or listen to that podcast to get that. But it's basically when they bring up something totally arbitrary and try and brush it aside in the beginning of the film. And you're like, why the fuck would they show them talking about that? Mm-hmm. And then later in the film, that thing becomes like the ultimate piece of whatever that's going to do something. The Freddy movies have a great example of this. But the one here is the silver thing. What is it? It's like a silver
letter opener.
Yeah. Who gives a letter opener, first
of all? The thing that's really funny is in the scene where they introduce the letter opener, it'd be one thing if she was like, I got you a letter opener, and then killed by werewolves. But instead she goes, be careful with that. Right. It's made of solid silver.
Yeah.
Which werewolves are weak against?
Yeah. Things are getting like hot and heavy in the tent. And she's like, wait, I got you this solid silver letter opener. Yeah. And they're like, okay. And then they get mauled by werewolves.
Yeah.
And they just, four weeks later, it's like, wait a second.
Yeah.
Why did that happen? And of course it comes back at the end. And of course fools me because that happens every time. I don't remember the like stupid silver letter opener thing because it's literally the first scene and it's so dumb. I'm just like, haha, whatever. Yeah. And then I'm like, well, did I miss the part where they use the letter opener? But no, it comes back at the very end.
I'm gonna attempt to coin a new term here from Dog Soldiers, because we see this a billion times in films. I think most notable being Cabin Fever, when Joey Kern comes out of the barn and he fucking made it.
Yeah.
But I'm gonna start referring to this as Sword Wolf.
Okay.
Where you go, well, that's everyone. Wait. And the film's like, you forgot about this guy.
Sword Wolf. Awesome.
The film like brushes a character aside and they're like, don't just forget about him. He's not important. Wait. Yes, he is. And you have the scene where the house explodes. Cooper's in the basement and Ryan, aka Sword Wolf, is like, what's up? And then there's a boxing match.
I really want to get into the werewolf thing. But before that, the one other thing this film does that is absolutely fucking awesome and reason enough to see the film, if for nothing else. So one of the ways that they stun the werewolves is by using flash photography on them.
And the thing is, like, during the course of the film, there were three of us watching this film, and all three of us were like, okay,
yeah
a camera, right? Uh-huh.
And then, and then it comes back.
Sure.
You think it's the lamest thing in the world. You're shrugging it off. And it doesn't come back till after the film.
Right.
The film is over. And then during the credits, you get the cheesiest like picture montage of all of the photos that developed from when the flash went off and shot pictures of the werewolf.
Yeah.
And it kind of gives you almost a little epilogue of like, here's what happened.
And you finally find out who won the footy game.
God. The epilogue is all we're getting. There was supposed to be a sequel to this. I don't know if you're aware of this.
Yeah, I know. I totally know. I'm totally aware. Like,
it just fell off the planet, which is probably what should have happened. So I want to ask you about werewolves. You and I have a vested interest in werewolves.
Totally.
We've been crafting a little werewolf side
project.
Our
vested interest comes from a former vested disinterest.
Well, yeah, exactly. We were sitting having coffee at Caribou one day, and you just totally posed the question to me, why do all werewolf films fucking suck?
Yep.
What is going on with werewolf films? Now, you got a lot of these kind of modern monster, you know, vampires, right? Mm-hmm. You got a lot of the vampire things. You can't even really lump zombie into that category because zombie films have taken off phenomenally. Sure. You know, this was probably after we saw 28 Weeks Later or whatever way back. And we're going through and, you know, zombies, you know, got their due, and like even vampires to some extent, you know, debatably have moments in film that are great. But you got nothing with werewolves, like since they were created.
Right. There's American Werewolf in Wherever the Fuck.
And then
Underworld.
And that's really it. You have people who try and do werewolf movies. I've seen a handful of them and they usually suck. First of all, why do werewolf films suck? And then sort of as an aside, because I think this film does something totally different than what we originally decided, you know, was a good idea to do with this. How do you make them better? What does this film do and what can other films do?
Well, the reason that I think most werewolf movies just utterly fail, part of it is the same reason that I hate vampire movies, or the majority.
Right.
And it's point one, werewolves and in parentheses and vampires are not sexy.
Mm-hmm.
They're evil, gross creatures that are like deformities of human beings and they hurt other people.
I have to. So before you launch into this, you remember we had Jeremy Kasten on the show. I was talking to Jeremy Kasten on the phone like a couple of weeks ago. Don't ask me how that happened. And you've seen The Thirst, right? Isn't there?
Yeah.
Is that what it's called? The Thirst.
Yeah.
film of his that I saw, really like low grade vampire movie. And he was like trying, we were talking back and forth about this, and he's trying to defend The Thirst to me. And the single thing that he was like so gung ho on is that it wasn't sexy vampires.
Yeah.
He was like, fuck that. What is the term he used? I believe he said faggy vampire shit. Yeah. immortal words of Mr. Jeremy Kasten. So that was his aim with that. But yeah, you see a lot of that, like sexy vampire. Do you get sexy werewolves? Does that happen?
It happens, dude. I mean, come on, Underworld.
Yeah, I guess that is like, sexy. Yeah, that is what that is.
You get sexy werewolves all the time.
Oh, well, that's absolutely what that is.
The thing that works about sex, the problem with sexy werewolves and the reason sexy werewolves are appealing is the same thing. When you make werewolves, their clothes can come off.
Yeah.
Because they turn into werewolves in what is without fail a shitty looking scene.
Yeah.
Where either a nose comes out of your mouth or your ears get hairy and then your clothes rip off and then you turn back and you're naked.
Yeah.
That's why werewolves are sexy.
And so I think the transformation is definitely one thing that sucks.
Fails.
And a thing that, you know,
fails.
We hit on that when we were kind of drafting, well, if you made a werewolf film, like how would you make one that didn't suck? Transformation was like the first thing.
Yeah.
We were like, well, those always suck 100% of the time. I would say even if John Carpenter did a version of this, you would still like, it wouldn't hold up. You know what I mean? Like you hand this to Tom Savini and it's going to suck in 10 years. No matter how good it looks at the time, it's going to be bad relatively soon, right? These things have such a half-life. It's ridiculous. So the transformation I think is bad. I would have said, and this is again, the opposite of what this film did, but I would have said, just don't show the werewolves. You got to do some silhouettes, do something. Because
Werewolves always look wrong.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, we had kind of an idea about that. And we can talk about that later or whatever. But this film just went with, we're going to put the werewolves right on the cover.
Yep.
Three of them hanging out in their 8-inch platform stilettos, whenever the werewolves are wearing giant boots. There they are.
Right.
They're right there. You're looking at them. If you got a problem, you're not going to pop this film in your DVD player. It's not like you started watching the film already and then, oh, there's werewolves and whatever. They're on the cover, you know, and you see them in the first scene. So like, if you're done with this film, you're done with it right away. And in this film, they don't take it too seriously, which I think is, you know, definitely another thing you can do to make your werewolf film not suck.
Yeah. I mean, I think, ultimately, I mean, we can go over what this film did right with werewolves. It doesn't take them seriously. It shows them flat out. They look kind of weird, whatever. But at the same time, like, I think the reason that werewolves worked is because Neil Marshall did the film.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, if there were a director to pull off werewolves, this is the guy. Because he's seen werewolves get fucked up.
Yeah.
And he's just like, dude, whatever. Like, we're just going to make werewolves.
They're just werewolves.
People are going to be pissed. There are going to be anti-werewolf people. And then there's just going to be anti-sucky creature people.
Yeah.
And we'll win over one of those audiences.
Yeah.
And the other audience can't be won over.
Yeah. You make the werewolves campy creatures.
Yeah.
And I think that's how, and then campy creature people watch your film.
Sure.
And because we haven't seen werewolf films.
No.
Have you seen werewolf films?
Like, I've seen them,
like, but I don't own them. You
and
know
they're
what I mean?
Awful.
Yeah.
They're all bad.
Yeah. So, you know, the werewolf audience, I don't know if that's an audience that needs to be pleased. Although I do think there are certain, you know, the Wolfman stuff, I'll always go back to that as classic stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But again, I think that's a different audience than would see your modern sexy werewolf film. I think the one other thing you can do, and they chose not to really do it here, but this is definitely something I would do with a werewolf film, is you got to have more going on than there's werewolves.
Yes.
You know, it's the same thing that, I mean, zombies got this from day one. The zombie shit, like for better or for worse, was always really psychological.
Sure.
And it always delved into like all of these different, you know, the Romero stuff was always about like political, it had political undertones to it.
Right.
And even today, it's a lot of this like survival and human interaction and stuff. And vampire stuff is kind of starting to get that. There's a couple of films who've latched onto it, but werewolf stuff without failure, like even to go back to like American Werewolf in London or its shitty, you know, American remake or Christina Ricci's Cursed, which is another great werewolf film.
Wes Craven's Cursed, please.
Oh God. You know, it's about the fact that there's werewolves.
Yeah.
And okay, I got that.
Right.
You could have just said that sentence to me.
Right.
Like I need more there.
Yeah.
I would love to see a really solid fucking story that just happens to have werewolves just as much as, you know, 28 Weeks Later is a solid story that happens to have zombies as the nature of its incident.
But I think that's where Dog Soldiers wins because it's like, dude, there's werewolves.
Yeah.
That is the movie. There are dogs. There are soldiers. Dog Soldiers.
Right.
So yeah, it just kind of comes back around to people being held down in a house.
Yeah, right.
Like another film, which raises the question, who is the true hostage?
So I guess we get into Hostage, which is the Bruce Willis film. Now, I expressed on the previous show that I was scared because I'd only seen this once. And before I ask you, I would just like to get this straight out that I'm glad I own Hostage. I like Hostage. I think it, you know, I was relieved almost immediately. I, you know, because I saw it once. I had it on DVD because I just remembered it being cool. And it's been like years since I've seen it. And I was dreading the worst. And I came away from it going like, damn, I'm glad I own that film. So I want to ask you, in typical Hollywood movie review fashion, because after all, we're dealing with what's basically a darker, more vulgar version of a, you know, Hollywood diehard-esque film. Does the style outweigh the script?
Before I answer that flat out, I just want to point out briefly that this podcast has always been about doing films that are notable, not necessarily films that are good.
Right.
That being said, this film is definitely notable because of how good it looks.
All right.
Whether that outweighs the script does not matter.
Thank you. That's exactly the right answer.
It looks really fucking good.
You know, somebody on another show might have caved to my ever so tempting question, but you're right. It doesn't fucking matter. And the answer is probably no. I think inherent in your response is the answer is no. Look, I'm not going to say the script was awful. I mean, it's based on a book.
Sure.
And they kept most of the stuff I'll be honest, like I haven't read the book, right? I'm an Ayn Rand guy. And outside of that, I don't really touch fiction. So I don't know anything about the book, but it's supposedly really close to it. And there's a lot of stuff in this movie that plot wise that I think is pretty solid. The way it comes together is a little iffy, but if nothing else, straight from the get go, you have the opening credits, which is what I remembered in my head as being the reason I had this. So I was afraid right after the credits started, because it goes straight into credits. And I was fearful that the movie would like, the credits were just the good thing and everything else about the movie looks shitty. These credits, you got to bring up Sin City because it's black and white and red. And anytime anybody does something kind of like animated and black and white and red, it's immediately Sin City.
Sure.
I think there's far more nuances to a Sin City style, but that's, you know, this is not the appropriate show for that conversation.
Right.
Suffice to say, this movie came out a good solid 25, 30 days before Sin City did. So I think it gets a pass regardless. I think you're safe. I would give it a pass anyways, but I think we're all right on the Sin City style and whether or not it's copying that. It moves from that into what is just like a fantastic looking film. I mean, it has art house written all over it. You know, it's very, very stylish. It almost looks like maybe like a Lucky McKee film. Or I'm trying to think of something else that, you know, I saw The Woods kind of recently. And The Fountain, maybe. It kind of feels like that a little bit. You know, that's the colorization.
Well, it kind of looks like if The Weatherman were more intense.
Yeah. All right. I guess I can, maybe. I'm not sure I follow you on that one, but I'll take it and move on. It's a very high contrast look. It's a little bit grainy. It's very stylized, you know? And if for no other reason, that would pull me through the film. And you look at something like The Fountain. The Fountain has a lot going for it. And we can talk about that on another show too. But The Fountain is mostly a drama. It doesn't have a whole lot of action shots. It's science fiction, so there's stuff to look at. But you could have gone through that whole movie just because it's artsy looking and a drama. With this, it's an action film. And like, I think you would agree with me that the intensity here is like fucking ridiculous.
Yeah, it totally is. Like, the thing about this film, right, when you have Bruce Lapidus in the beginning.
Right. Looks like Jeff Fahey.
Yeah. I want to say it's too intense, but given the situation, it's probably accurate.
Right.
However, I think it's too intense too fast and you have no way of getting into it.
Yeah.
And as soon as it loses you, you're lost.
Yeah. It doesn't fuck around with the intensity. Yeah. It's like from frame one.
Yeah.
I mean, the opening scene of this thing is the hostage situation where the fucking kid gets shot.
Yeah, exactly.
Like the other kid's all bloody. So you know right away that this is another one of those movies. I think this is officially the fourth time we've invoked Robert Rodriguez on this show.
That's fine.
But, you know, I just got done reading Rebel Without a Crew, and he talks a lot about just when he was writing the script for Mariachi, how he likes to write these movies where I won't tell you who dies, but almost everybody in all of his films dies. And I didn't even think about that until I was reading that. And I was like, yeah, and pretty much everything but like Spy Kids, all of his characters die. So much so that he has to bring back, because he only uses like five of the same actors. He has to bring them back in different roles because all the fucking characters are dead by the end. This is a movie that doesn't pull the punches. It'll kill the kid. It'll kill the dog, you know, in much the same way as Dog Soldiers, you know, no problem with that. Mm-hmm. And I think that is sort of, it's sort of your, hey, heads up, this is going to be intense. But I mean more even in the technical precision, in the mechanics. The score does that a little bit, but mostly, like you pointed out, like the guns look like they're all like fucking gas carbine rifles. Yeah. Like everybody's shooting a Desert Eagle.
Yeah,
it's
right.
Ridiculous.
Like everything a gun hits almost explodes.
Yeah, it basically explodes. Yeah. I always think, oh, you know, and there's a lot of really, really quick, awesome edits, you know, in this whole section, and a lot of great, again, technical precision as far as the violence, I guess you would say, the gun hits and stuff. But I always remember in the beginning, where Ben Foster is like shooting at the, so a squad car comes in and this chick is like checking out the situation, this police officer. And first of all, he fucking shoots her, which you're like, what?
Yeah.
So by that point, you're just like, all right, I guess this is what we're going for. You know, like you hold your breath, you dive in. That's all there is to it. And I just remember one of the shots of him like shooting at the car and like the windshield shattering or the fucking like the siren on top is just like
blowing up.
Yeah, I mean, it's really intense. I think the intensity, it's one of those elements that almost puts you off at first. But think about this. Try and imagine them selling you this bullshit, like super dramatic high tension hostage crisis if things weren't blowing up and exploding left and right. And if like everyone but Bruce Willis basically wasn't way overacting their part. I think it would be just another boring like hostage movie. And
I don't know.
Care.
I mean, up until earlier this year, I would probably agree with you. But recently I saw a film that was, I came out of New Zealand called Out of the Blue, which is based on a true story. It's about a guy who goes nuts, starts shooting people.
Sure.
And it is the intensity is so not like they don't focus on it. And that's what makes it scary because they're like, this is really happening.
Yeah.
This is a guy who snapped, he's shooting everybody. And they're not like trying to over-stylize it. And I think that's probably... I mean, but like, unless you're going to do it that way, which this film, like with all of the, you know, double, triple, quadruple, like who's being double crossed, who's the true hostage.
Right.
That film, this film would fail if it were trying to like imbue you with reality versus like intensity and full throttle. Like
full throttle is really what it is. I mean, I think we've talked about it before with a film like A History of Violence that is, of course, violent, but in, you know, it has kind of these long, slow-moving pieces between the violence. So when you see the violence, it's twisted and it like shocks you. I know we talked a little bit about Funny Games too. Kind of does that a little bit. It's sort of something different. But you know what I mean? Like stuff along that lines. And I think this is a totally different approach. You know, to make the film like that, I think, sure, okay, it could be done. I always think back too to Dog Day Afternoon, another one of those. It's really early, maybe the first Al Pacino picture that came to this country anyways. And that was something that wasn't ultra violent or anything, but you know, those films do different things. This film, I think all it has to it writing wise is to be high octane thriller because I don't know that that script could do anything else. I don't think you would buy the twists. I want to know, are you buying any of them before I move into my alternate theory of how this film could have accomplished them? At what point is it just too much for you?
It's too much for me when Ben Foster starts shooting the cop.
Yeah, that's the point where you're just like, what's...
Like, and maybe I'm just jaded and fucking tired of it, but I'm sick of the one renegade on the crew of bad guys.
Yeah.
You know, there's always, it's...
Do you know where else you've seen that? Because I can't say I've seen a lot of that.
I've seen it over and over. There's always like a crew of people. There's a crew of bad guys.
Right.
And then there's one guy who's so much badder.
Right. And he's the wild card.
Yeah. You're like, everybody's on the same side. You know, everybody's doing it. And you have a leader. And then you have like a sub, you have like another guy who just like snaps. And you're like, whoa, dude, like we're criminals, but you're crazy.
Right.
And I'm just tired of that. And as soon as he shot the cop, I was like, oh, we're going to have this. We're going to have the renegade bad guy.
Maybe you're right. Maybe you're right. When I saw it, I was okay with that. But now that you mentioned that, and I'm starting to think back to instances that's been done. And yeah, all right. So I don't really want to see that. But that's not even where things bother me. The stuff that bothers me, and you hit on it so good in your intro, is who is the real hostage?
Yeah.
And I mean, you kind of say it as a joke, but really, that's kind of what the film was doing. You know, you get
literally
this point where
every character that has more than like six speaking lines is a hostage.
Their father is a hostage. Yeah. You know, they bring him out and Bruce Willis, for one reason or another, we'll get to, has to basically like keep him around so he can answer questions and help him.
Right.
And then the family obviously are the hostages. Right.
The family's the hostage, both families.
Yeah.
Hostages. The guys in the house are hostages.
Yeah.
Ben Foster's a hostage.
Well, and the guy Foster, who, what's his name? Mars, I think.
Yeah. In
the
Marshall film. Mars.
Mars is terrorizing the other two kind of. So they're hostages to him.
The,
although he's emotionally a hostage.
The medic
as well.
In the ambulance is a hostage.
Yeah.
And,
you're forgetting the big one is Bruce Willis's family.
Well, yeah. Hostages. Well, that's why I said both families.
Oh, right.
And then the men in the masks are hostages to Bruce Willis because he has information they need.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's absolutely true. And you said this at some point during the film where, you know, like every time the hostage twist kind of happens, I just snicker at it. But at what point I think you literally said like, who's the real hostage now or something. I'm just like, oh, this film is just crumbling.
Well, then I pointed out that it's quite possible that the true hostage is the audience.
So when I say that the writing is bad, that is particularly what I mean. I don't need all these twists and turns.
Sure.
And I think that was like a late 90s, early 21st century kind of thing is like a lot of these movies that had to like have a twist every 5 seconds. Mm-hmm. You can't guess the twist, blah, blah, blah.
I think it's less of a twist and more bet you didn't see that coming or the plot thickens.
Yeah. Yeah. The plot thickens definitely. And I think if the movie would have, I don't want to say rested more so, maybe just cut that stuff out.
Right.
You know? The film, and this is another great thing I can commend the film for, is it's like 2 hours long. I don't feel like it really drug.
No, it doesn't drag.
Maybe because they kept switching up the hostages, but I mean, think
at the same time, it doesn't need to be that long.
Yeah, right.
But it's not that it's too long.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, the extended length gives them some opportunities to, for instance, showcase different visual styles.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, you know, when I spoke about The Fountain, it's just because The Fountain's a very like orange and yellow kind of movie, and I think of that style, but you get a bunch of different styles in this from the opening negotiation, that kind of desaturated look. You have all the stuff inside the house, which is just very expensive and very sleek. You have the stuff outside towards the end that's like very blue and white and glowing.
And then you have the fire end in the house. Right.
The fire stuff like is amazing in this.
Absolutely.
The
fire looks fucking incredible. Intense. And not only is the fire cool, but they did a lot of cool stuff with editing where they would slow shit down. Like as much as it was like one of the stupidest things I have ever seen in
the
a film
moment. Is that what you're
when
at?
Ben Foster is just being Brandon Lee. Yeah. And he's running down the hallway with the two Molotov cocktails and the hallway's on fire and he's just Desperado or The Crow, take your pick depending on, you know, which is your favorite. And he's just in slow motion and all black, this like dark hellbent silhouette. It was the stupidest fucking thing ever.
Yeah, it's
pretty
bad. But
it looked so good.
Yeah, what do you think? Why is that so bad? Why does a movie like we mentioned The Crow? The Crow is basically not quite the same thing, you know, not that scene verbatim, but it does a lot of that like guy carrying guns down a dimly lit hallway, going to kick some ass. I think maybe because you're more along for the film isn't as much of a joke to you.
I think the line is drawn when you tell me what the film's about.
Yeah.
If you tell me the film is about a family that's been taken hostage in their home and there's a negotiator who's got to get them out.
Right.
I'm not going to be able to handle slow motion crow moment.
Yeah.
But if you tell me that the film is about a guy who died and was brought back to life by a crow in order to avenge his girlfriend.
Yeah.
Yeah, walk slowly down the hallway with guns. I'm down. I'm with you.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Be a badass.
Yeah, I could see that. I mean, there's these moments that are really, really dark, and there's moments that are really, again, vulgar and violent. And I like all of those moments. I want to keep them in, but maybe put them in a different way.
Yeah.
All of Ben's stuff, he's a really dark character.
Yeah.
He's really fucking disturbed
there's
as he
the,
is in
the
like
bang
everything.
Scene.
Yeah, there's that. Anytime he's talking to the girl, it's just fucking awkward and dark. And if anything redeems the burning moment, it's because her shirt said burn it in the beginning and he wrote it in blood. And I was just like, ha, check that out. So that stuff's all right. But you see it and it just doesn't quite come together. I still want to keep all that dark, brooding, like psychologically fucked stuff.
Yeah.
But for some reason, like the elements just aren't combining into a scene that works for me.
I think the trick is to just put on Hostage, mute it, and listen to Ghosts 1-4.
Yeah, instead of the mysterious score they were pulling in here.
Well,
too.
The score that makes you think things that the film isn't letting you think.
I mean, again, score is another one of those elements. A great metaphor for the rest of the film, I guess, or at least an example of one of the things. But the score is really solid. The score is mysterious. I love the score to this, and yet somehow it doesn't really fit the movie.
Yeah,
it's more of these like elements, like the crow scene. like the stylization, that for some reason, when they come together, the like, again, the sum of the parts, you know, it's just not, the individual things are just far better than when they come together to create this movie. I just feel like for all the work that went into each of these elements, you could have achieved something a lot greater, but at the same time, it's still way better than most of the bullshit out there. Like if your goal was just to make an artsy hostage movie, if I was like, hey, here's a movie you can't make good, the hostage premise, and you're like, all right, I'm going to art house this shit and we'll see what happens. I think this is a great example of that. All right. So what are we doing next time? This is the most efficient show ever. Look at this shit.
Next time is our French ragtag theme show.
Yeah, that should be a good one.
Which, you know, every show has to have a French ragtag theme.
Yeah, sure.
So next time we're going to do Rififi from your collection.
Rififi has a really long French title. I think everyone, I think it's okay to just call it Rififi.
Okay.
I don't think anyone's going to call us out on that because you know what happens when I try and pronounce French.
Or anything. And mine is the French animated, The Triplets of Belleville.
All right, that should be good. We're going to do that whole show in subtitles or what's the gimmick there?
I'm going to talk in French and you're going to tell people what I'm saying.
Okay, that'll work. Before we close out, we have a website, doublefeatureshow.com. You ever use that? It's a good site. You should check it out.
All right.
No, I'm serious. Go to it.
Okay.
Also, you can get to our MySpace and our Facebook from there. You can send us a email or you can do that. It's doublefeatureshow@gmail.com. Leave us a review on iTunes. We have reviews on there. Have you seen any of those? They're kind of funny.
Okay. I'll look them up.
Try and leave us a review that's funnier than the reviews that are currently up. And that's it. I'm out of steam. That's all I got.
Watch more fucking film.
Bye.
Next time is our French ragtag. Sorry, our French ragtag.
Do you
want to
try that whole thing again?
Next time is our French ragtag. Oh my God, ragtag. I'm sorry.
What is a ragtag?
It's a. I'm not going to answer that.